Good day to you all, and welcome to this meeting of the leaders of the VDM project, many of whom are soon to be founding members of the iFloaters Foundation. I just want to spend a few minutes updating the world on our recent activities and some of the projects that we're working on to help sufferers who have vision degrading myodysopsia, to wit the acronym VDM. I was fortunate enough to present the results that we have had in a subgroup of patients who have vitreous floaters and also had previously undergone cataract surgery with multifocal intraocular lenses. And I realize that that's a problem that exists in older people, and that many of you are younger and have not had cataract surgery. But I believe that it does a few things at the proof of principle level. The first is that there can be more than one reasons that people have decreased vision, specifically degraded contrast sensitivity function, which is the ability to discern shades of gray. And in this group of patients, the reasons were that they have a certain type of intraocular lens implant that is known to impact contrast sensitivity function, but they also have opacities in the vitreous. And it was not known prior to our study whether these people would benefit or not. And what we found in 180 patients was that they did indeed get better contrast sensitivity function, on the order of 37% better. And while that may not sound like a lot, they were considerably happier. These are people who are unhappy with the outcomes of their cataract surgery. And so we were able to make them happier by doing a limited vitrectomy. And so addresses an unmet need within this group of unhappy patients, but once again demonstrates that vitreous is the cause, and that a treatment to vitreous, admittedly an invasive treatment at this stage, being limited vitrectomy, can be effective. And the thing that's different about this presentation that I made is that it was to a group of cataract surgeons. Up until now, most of my presentations have been either to the general ophthalmology population or the retinal specialists. But here I ventured out into an area. I've never been to any of their meetings before, and it was in Washington, D.C. And so I began the process of extending what we know to a broader audience. And to stimulate these people to think about vitreous when they're dealing with an unhappy cataract patient. And so that presentation was in April. I also presented this material to the American Ophthalmological Society. This is an organization that's multidisciplinary. So there are pediatric ophthalmologists, cornea specialists, et cetera. And it was very well received and achieved what I had hoped, which was a connection to a group of anterior segment surgeons who are dedicated to improve vision, meaning that they have strategies to improve vision surgically before cataracts develop, meaning that they can do treatments on clear lenses and not wait for patients to get old enough to have dense cataracts that anybody would remove. The point being that they're looking more proactively into improving vision for patients who don't have great vision. They can see 20/20, but they still don't have great vision. And when I presented our findings with vitreous, they felt that this fell perfectly in line with their philosophy of seeking ways to improve vision, even though by standard criteria, vision is already good, meaning it's 20/20. But visual acuity of 20/20 is not the be-all and end-all of vision. There are many other aspects to vision, as we have learned over the years, through involvement and research in vitreous and how it impacts vision. So there's a lot more that needs to be done. On May 10th of this year, the American Journal of Ophthalmology published the results of the information that I presented to the American Society of Cataract and Refractive Surgery in Washington, D.C. on April 25th, and to the American Ophthalmological Society in Colorado on May 21st. And so now it's in the public domain, and I think that it's going to stimulate a lot of interest among people who were never interested in vitreous before, or at least that's my hope. And that publication should go very far in legitimizing everything, because it's a very highly ranked peer-reviewed journal that is well respected within the medical community. That pretty much summarizes the most recent results of the work that the VDM project and all of its donors have supported. We have a number of ongoing projects that I'll be happy to share with you at this time, unless anyone in the group has a question about what I just described. That's a very good question, and one that we have thought of in the past, because we hear that from patients all the time. Individuals who have two large monitors at their work station, and they go back and forth from one to the other, complain of exactly what you said, that they have objects in their vision which are off center, but once their eyes move horizontally, those objects move into their line of sight, and they have to wait until they shift out of their line of sight before they can continue whatever visual task they're undertaking. Reading and driving are two very good real life examples of how the vitreous can impact visual function. Acuity can be 20/20, but your ability to read is not good. There was one study of only 20 patients done at four different centers, published in a very low impact journal because it wasn't a very good study, that used a method to measure vision and found that vitrectomy used a method to measure reading speed, reading accuracy, and the results were that vitrectomy improved that. So we went and purchased the equipment and the software, again, with funds raised by the VDM project to support this research. And we tried to develop that platform for the purpose of adding reading as one of our clinical parameters to evaluate patients and determine whether their affliction is mild, moderate, or severe. We concluded that that was not a good, reliable way to do that. And so we are searching for other ways to measure the speed and accuracy of reading as an index of the impact vitreous opacities can have on visual function. I recently found out of a testing paradigm for driving. Because when you're driving and you're looking around, particularly when you're scanning to the side view mirror on the left in the US and on the right in the UK, it's nonetheless that horizontal movement that displaces the vitreous and can create bothersome opacity disturbance to vision, which in driving situations can be very dangerous. You don't have a lot of time to be waiting for your vitreous to move out of your line of sight and be able to see well. So we're looking into reading and we're looking into driving as new indices with which to measure vitreous. To measure vision in patients impacted. But right along these lines, I am doing research right now with a group of physicists at UCLA who can measure the viscosity of vitreous. And so the hypothesis is that abnormal viscosity can translate into the movement artifact that we're talking about. And there may be some keys in understanding the phenomenon, which always has to occur before you can treat the phenomenon. And so vitreous that we're removing at surgery is being analyzed in this laboratory at UCLA in search of an explanation for, is there an alteration of viscosity that can explain the way the vitreous moves during horizontal eye movements that help us understand why some people have floaters that are really bothersome and others don't. It may have something to do with the viscosity of vitreous, and if that's true, it may open the door for treatment strategies that modify the vitreous. A similar study that we're doing right now in this context is to determine the displacement of vitreous in different positions of the body. Many patients have said to me over the years that Sunday mornings, their vitreous or their floaters bother them the most, in addition to driving, in addition to reading, and in some instances, skiing and fishing and surfing, et cetera. And so there are a number of things that apply to that observation. And one thought that we had was that when waking up Sunday morning, it tends to be later in the morning, it tends to be more light in the room. You tend to be looking up at your ceiling, which is usually white. And those are the circumstances that highlight the opacities that cause the vitreous floaters. But the question was also, does the vitreous move closer to the macula? And could that explain the heightened symptoms during a reclining position? So we took a series of 43 patients and measured the distance between the back surface of the vitreous and the optic disc, sitting up, and then having them lie down in the supine position and measuring it again using ultrasound. And we found a statistically significant displacement of the posterior vitreous closer to the back of inside of the back of the eye, which has implications vis-a-vis the experience that I just described, but also treatment strategies. Because if, for example, you're going to use a laser of some sort, it matters whether the patient is sitting up or the patient is lying down as to the safety profile. And so there are a number of very interesting things that result from that study, and we're in the closing stages of that. We'll be writing it up and then publishing it. And once it's in the public domain, I can be freer to discuss the details. But I think it's part and parcel with what I was describing before, understanding the biochemical and biophysical parameters of vitreous in patients with vision-degrading myodysopsia and how that differs from other circumstances. It's a rather important thing. We have with us a doctor from the University of Freiburg who's come over for a 6-month fellowship to do research on vitreous, both basic science as well as clinical. And she has helped us write 3 review articles on cells within the vitreous. It's really not directly relevant to vision-degrading myodysopsia, but we're doing intensive research in collaboration with the University of Freiburg on transcriptional profiling, meaning measuring the RNA in samples that we are removing at surgery for patients with VDM, and seeing whether we get insight into what's going on inside the eyes from the RNA standpoint in an attempt to understand this phenomenon better. I have been invited by the American Academy of Ophthalmology to lecture at their annual meeting on October 3rd in a debate format as to whether or not patients with vision-degrading myodysopsia, which is the term we use to refer to clinically significant vitreous floaters, whether or not they should undergo vitrectomy. And so it's a debate structure, meaning there'll be a pro and a con and then a rebuttal. But I think it's an opportunity to speak before a broad audience that at the very least raises to people's level of awareness the existence of this problem and its significance in the community at large, the international community. And, you know, I have said often in the past that in spite of being a surgeon and in spite of being aware that when you're a hammer, all the world is a nail, I think that vitrectomy has been proven to be safe and effective. And I'll be the first to admit that in 25 years, this problem will not be treated by vitrectomy, at least not in many patients. We'll have better solutions. But for the time being, it's a very good solution and it's made many patients very much happier. So all of the work that we're doing is striving to raise levels of awareness, to educate the community at large, to develop strategies to stimulate governments and foundations and universities to be interested in this problem and to harness their resources to focus on this problem and to contribute to the development of new strategies and new solutions for the betterment of the lives of all of those who suffer from vision degrading myodysopsia. And again, I want to thank all of the members of this group who have donated their time and brought their skills and expertise to focus on this problem and to pursue various strategies to improve the lot of all of those throughout the world. So I'm very grateful for everything that you're doing. Thank you.